Dan Rosen joining us. The competition committee meeting, recommendation for rules changes. Fascinating stuff as we look at it. I want to get your reaction, especially on regular season tiebreakers. As we're in the playoffs, that was something that got a lot of attention.
One of the things with regular season tiebreakers is just the committee's going to, I have to actually look at it because it's so wordy on all this stuff. The committee's going to adopt a proposal that would modify them, and they want to make regulation wins matter greatly, and that's the big thing. But Tony, to be honest with you, the key thing on that is expanded video replay.
That's
the number one thing, and it was very vague what they put out yesterday because I think they're still working on it, massaging things that they want to do. It still has to go to the executive board of the NHLPA and the Board of Governors. We'll hear a lot more about this next week when the Board of Governors meets in Vegas. We're going to hear a lot more about it and maybe get some, you know, firm details on what they're looking at. But the fact that they're going to go to expanded video replay and modifications potentially to the coach's challenge and giving the officials a chance to look at their own calls, these are things a lot of people have been calling for. And obviously the NHL, the NHLPA, the competition committee, they hear the calls for it, and they're listening, and they're looking forward to it. And Gary Bettman hinted at this, obviously, in his press conference before the series started, that they know they're going to do this. They have to look at it. It's just, how far do you go? How far down do you go with video replay? That's where they got to. It's not easy. It's not as just black. This isn't a black and white issue. So they got to figure out how far to go, and I think they've probably got a lot of the legwork done already on this. And this was very vague, what we got yesterday from the competition committee. But I think we'll hear a lot more next week.
I like the fact that these things have been the hot topic here for a while in the league, talking about and speaking about doing something about it. I like the fact that they're keeping it vague because, you know what? They've got it all figured out right now. They need time with it and to figure it out. What does that mean? I know we were talking with a referee yesterday. And
now you're back.
He said, this referee in particular said, it would be great if we just got, if we had the opportunity to say, hey, I think it was this, but I'm not sure. I'd like to take a look at this one. I think it would make all the difference in the world.
Not a penalty. Not a penalty. Not a hooking or a slashing.
Right.
Yeah. Or think
something that really
pass,
alters the game.
A hand pass, a puck off the net, which we've seen obviously in these playoffs. I think those things are probably the things that they're looking at. I don't think you can go, like we talk about the Tyler Bozak, did he trip Nolichari, did he not? Look, that happens in the flow of play. I don't think you can go back and look at penalties, but certainly you can look at the puck off the netting, the hand pass, the high stick. Was a goal scored on a high stick or not?
A major penalty, maybe a major penalty too.
The goal scored on a high stick, I mean, they're seeing that in real time, so give him a chance. Go back and look at those things. I think that's what we'll see. We'll get more of an indication, obviously, next week.
What about if they, the thing that I like as well is, if you're going to have these challenges from coaches, that you still punish those challenges if they're wrong by penalties. So that's how you can weed out a lot of them. So it's just not every marginal 50. We don't want 50-50 calls being challenged every single time. If you're adamant, 80-20, let's challenge this one, then that's when you should.
What about some of the new faces in the competition committee? Do you think that spurred some of the discussions, perhaps some new perspectives in those discussions, would you say?
I think so. I think anytime you get new voices in, right, it matters. You have guys that are fresh on the ice. They're playing the game. You've got coaches who are there. You've got managers. You've got referees. You've got executives. I think it's a great mixture of people. And I like the fact that they're keeping it in-house a little bit. They walked out of the office in Toronto yesterday, and nobody said a word. They just said, there were people on the street in Toronto waiting to talk to the media.
That's the best.
They didn't say anything. They
keep
said, we're going to hand out it, you know.
Yes.
Keep it hush, because now they can keep it hush, come together on one big thing with the executive board of the NHLPA and the Board of Governors, come together on an agreement there, and now you've got something. Now you've got what you're looking for, and it's all sides on board with it.
From keeping it hush to the other end of the spectrum, maybe the loudest roar we've heard in that building, the Tory crew kids.
Yeah.
We saw the graphic that showed something about playing with or without a helmet.
Yeah.
This could have been a much different scenario. Take
right,
us through
100%.
That.
As soon as his helmet would have fallen off when he was wrestling basically in front of the net with David Perron, he would have had to go to the bench.
Right.
Right. Now, that's the rule that the general managers proposed. Now, the question I think that they're wrestling with is, what's reasonable, right? So in a situation like that one, he has plenty of time to go to the bench. A guy can come off the ice. But if it's in the flow of play, the puck's in their zone, helmet pops off. If Tory Krug is in that situation, but the Blues have the puck, and his helmet comes off, and he has to go to the bench immediately, that's a 5-on-4 for what, 10, 15 seconds, right? That's an advantage for them. Now, strap your helmet on better is one thing they'll say, but I think that's one thing. They said they wanted to go forward with a rule like this, but, you know, construct a rule that would be allow a player reasonable, was the word, reasonably get off the ice in a reasonable situation. And that's another thing. They're probably, remember, the wording on rules matters.
Very much so.
And the wording on rules matters, and they're not, you tinker with that wording a little bit, it changes the rule. So they think they want to make sure that they all are in agreement on the rule that they want. They are in agreement that they want the rule. It's just a matter of how far will they go, what's the wording of that rule.
Craig Berube has tinkered with his lineup before Game 7. Joel Edmondson back in. He was asked about that earlier today.
Exciting times. Obviously, everyone's nervous, I think, on both teams, but, you know, it's going to be a hell of a game tonight. We're excited, and we're a confident group right now, so we're just looking to get things going. Yeah, I've played in, I think, 3 Game 7s now, so this is going to be my 4th, and, I mean, none have compared to this one, so it's obviously going to be the biggest game of my life, and just like I said, everyone's excited. I went right to my phone and texted my parents. They're obviously excited, and just excitement right now. You know, kind of push the nerves to the side, and you just want to get out there and play. I think once the puck drops, all the nerves will go. So, you know, 8 o'clock can't come soon enough.
Edmondson in. Robert Bortuzzo out. Blay and Barbashev in. Robert Thomas out. Barbashev, of course, returning from that 1-game suspension. Dan, your read on these moves?
Well, the Barbashev move to me is a simple move. That fourth line is effective when he's on it, and with Sundqvist and Alexander Steen, that he is suspended for Game 6, or else he wouldn't have missed it. He's going to be back in the lineup, no question about it. Robert Thomas didn't practice yesterday, didn't practice today, clearly not healthy, wasn't effective when he went back on the lineup. So Sammy Blais moved to the line, the third line, where he was playing with Pat Maroon and Tyler Bozak. So I understand those. The interesting one to me is Joel Edmondson, and I get it, because what he wants, what Craig Berube wants, Alex Pietrangelo and Colton Parayko are going to need him a ton of minutes on the right side.
Sure.
Right? They might each play 30 tonight, the way it goes. It's Game 7. You leave it all out there.
There is no tomorrow.
Joel Edmondson is a lefty. So is Vince Dunn. You know, so is Jay Bouwmeester. So is Carl Gunnarsson. Now he's got 4 lefties that he can rotate around with the 2 righties. Say Vince Dunn, he only wants to use him on the power play, right? He's maybe want a little bigger body in there on the lefty, so you move those guys around a little bit, right? You play it that way. You rotate your 4 and leave your 2, because your 2 are going to eat up all the time on the right side. There's no reason to have Robert Bortuzzo there in that sense. He's a righty, but he wouldn't play very much, and you don't want him playing on his offside that much.
You know what that says to me if I'm on the Boston Bruins?
What?
Make these guys pay from the first shift.
Absolutely.
You got to make Parayko, Pietrangelo, every shift, feel every shift, make them work every shift. Hold on the pucks in the offensive zone. Make them spend some time. Just like in football, when you have the defense on the field for a long time, wear them out, wear them out. And that's the big thing, because he's showing his cards here.
I like the move, but
he's showing his cards.
I don't think anybody doubts the fact that he's Parayko and Pietrangelo.
Right.
Like, that's not a surprise, the Bruins captain.
But he's kind of saying here, though, by verbalizing it, he's saying, our other 4 are going to be spotted in. We're almost going, in some ways, with 2 set of D tonight. 4 guys.
You have Vince Dunn. He's going to play on the power play, right? But how much even strength time is Vince Dunn going to get, right? So you have Edmondson's a bigger body. If you want to play a physical game, you throw Edmondson out there for a couple of shifts, and, you know, he bangs it around a little bit. He can play in the offensive zone. He's got some skill in the O zone there, too. But you're right. He's showing their cards. So if you're the Bruins, you're going to need a couple things. You need good breakouts, right? Number one, you have to be able to break the puck out well, or else you can't punish Pietrangelo and Parayko. If you can break the puck out well, dump it in their corner. Make them turn. Make them go get it. Hit them. Grind them. Make them feel it in the third period, because if we, you know, it could be a tight game, third period. If you're grinding on those right-handed defensemen, they will feel it in the third period. What if it goes to overtime? They'll feel it even more, right?
If they're playing grind 30, them. They got to be a long 30.
Yeah.
Explain what you mean by that.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Well, if they're playing, not if. We know that they're certainly capable. Yeah. These 2 guys are absolute studs, and they've been a stud. And again, I like the move. But if they're playing a 30, you make sure they're working on the defense. defensive side of the puck for 30 minutes. So if I'm in the corner and I have the puck and I think a guy is open in the slot, I'm not throwing it there. Right. I'm not going to give them a free out to get out of the zone. Just hold it. Let the guy grind some more. Extend some shifts. Maybe just be a little more selective in the offensive zone.
What do you have to save it for, boy? This game sets.
There is no tomorrow.
Come on. Some oxygen in you.
That's what Apollo Creed said to Rocky. There is no tomorrow.
There's no tomorrow.
Carl Weathers, we love you.
I got two
games.
We're
looking at game one of next year.
Let's go.
Get out of town.
You know who's excited to be back? And we're excited because we root for the health of all the players. Matt Grizzly. He was having a terrific playoffs. Son of John on the Bull Gang. Such a great story. His impact coming back in.
Well, I think his impact could be significant. A, he's back in a familiar spot. He'll probably play on the left side of the third pair, okay? And the other thing is he's a better puck mover and puck distributor and breakout guy than Connor Clifton. Connor Clifton has been okay, but not great. So you take Connor Clifton out. He hasn't been that effective, certainly as the series has gone on. Grizzly comes in, fresh body, right? Hasn't played in a while. He's fresh. He has been skating with the team. Hasn't been taking contact, but there's not a lot of contact in practice anyway. I mean, you have Krug and Grizzly here. You might flip them. That might be the way it goes. Who knows? They'll be bouncing around that way. But I think he's a better breakout guy. I think he's a better skater, or can be. A little more confident. And he grew up in this building.
Yes.
Literally.
That's true.
Come on.
Truly.
Now you're back, Dad.
How big is that?
You're on the perimeter a little bit, but you're back now.
He grew up in this building. You think this guy's going to be on for game 7?
You thought you were at the other garden, but now you're back,
man.
Bro.
He grew up in this building.
That's
Dad's
true.
Dad's going to be there. Brother's going to be there.
It's true.
Like, do you think this guy, he's, by the way, he's won a championship in this building. He won the bean pot.
Yes.
Yeah, in this building, right?
That's true.
So I think he scored the overtime
goal.
That
is true.
Right? In the bean pot. This is his home. He deserves to play in game 7. He belongs in game 7.
You got some oxygen when we went to that.
Yeah,
I like it.
Fired up.
That a boy.
Great stuff, Dan Rosen. Enjoy game 7.
Yes, thank you.